Over the years, I've done a lot of cool stuff on my bike. I've done the Alps, the Pyrenees, the Dolomites. I've even won a very low level race on it. One thing that I have never done, and it might surprise you, is get a professional bike fit. So today, I'm gonna change all that. I'm gonna get my position scrutinized by a professional. How far out can it be? Right then, Luke, I'm trusting my position in your hands.
We're gonna start off by looking at your feet. Mm-hmm. Now, your foot and pedal connection is probably the most important part of the fit. Mm. If your foot is unstable, you're probably gonna be experience some instability in the saddle area. And if those two points are unstable or poor connection, where's the one point you're gonna grip and kind of try and provide all your stability through? It's gonna be through the front end. You get a lot of tension and discomfort through your hands, your shoulders, your upper body. Big issue we come across is people really liking, so for example, you're running this S-Work shoe, a great shoe, but they're often for someone who has a fairly narrow foot. Now, people love the look of S-Work shoes, but they may need a super wide fitting shoe because they have a wide foot. Now, the problem is they go into a shop to try these on and they don't come to a bike fitter. They're probably gonna be a 42 wide and they'll probably put the 44 on and think, ah, this feels comfortable for me. The problem is then the cleat location, the holes are drilled then for a foot that is structured at 44.
Yeah.
So that's something we need to bear in mind. So this part of the process is having a look at the structure of your feet, width, arch height, lots of different things like that.
I know I'm a 43. I try on a few different shoes that are our size 43 and choose ones which sort of feel like they might fit. But yeah, I've never considered arch support. I put my cleats somewhere near the middle and then I go on a ride and hope it's comfortable. So I've probably just been going for a 43 blindly my whole life.
I would say you're 42 shoe size. And again, 42 on a branded device is not going to be the same across all shoes.
Yeah.
So this is why going to bike fitter who offers a shoe fitting service is the best way to potentially find a shoe that's going to fit you best. So these are the two options I use mostly when I'm fitting. So this is what I call a generic insole. So this one just allows you to apply different volume spaces under the arch.
That comes off, doesn't it?
Yep, so that's Velcro. That just comes off and you can fit, as I said, different sizes once we've measured your arch to find out what's going to fit you best. The better option and what we're going to be doing for you today is it's a custom insole. So we heat this up and we mold this carbon plate underneath to your arch. This is needed when someone has a left-right imbalance within their arches. But this will dictate a lot of the things you potentially see in the fit, which is why if someone just comes in, chucks you on a bike,
get out of it.
Bit of a red flag. So yeah, I'm just feeling how your scapula, your muscle and bone connection is. We're gonna check some range of motion now of your joints and your flexibility. So what we're looking at here is just mainly looking for imbalances. As I said previously, functionality is completely different. People are sitting at desk jobs, spend a lot of time in cars. Some people are riding loads. The main thing I'm looking out for is if there's any flexibility issues that are gonna limit us on the bike.
Yeah.
Especially if you're looking to get faster and potentially want to go more aggressive, this is where that kind of comes in. And then looking at, see if there's any left to right imbalances. All of this we need to bear in mind to paint a bigger picture, but 100% going away and working on flexibility is gonna be something that I recommend.
Mm-hmm. Now, Luke, a big part of bike fitting is obviously your three contact points. One of those, perhaps the most important, is the saddle. Now, I've got through a lot of saddles in the last year or so. Try to find the one that works for me. I'm lucky enough to try lots of saddles. This one's even 3D printed to my rear.
That is cool.
Anyway, a lot of saddles, you can get some really lightweight ones.
Yep.
Like, feel that one. That is proper light.
Yeah.
Is something like that always going to be uncomfortable because there's no padding on it?
A lot of people I come across when I'm bike fitting assume that cycling saddles are not meant to be comfortable. They, when I start talking to them at the start of the fit and mm-hmm. we're talking about saddle discomfort, they're like, oh, I'm perfectly fine. Yeah, no, I'm good. Later on, we kind of get into chatting more and they're like, oh, I do get saddle sores, I guess. Yeah, I guess I get some genital numbness. Now, that shouldn't be the case.
So no saddle sores, no numbness.
It's a big question, but generally you should be able to ride your bike with a relative degree of comfort, get off after 2, 3, 4 hours, depending on your functionality, and feel not beaten up. People come in here often with a bag of 10 saddles and they go, I can't find one that works for me. Now, mm-hmm. saddle selection is not this massive minefield. There's not like this perfect saddle for you. There's not a perfect saddle for me. There's a few things that we're looking out for during a fitting process, and we want to understand to then guide what saddle's going to work best. One of them is measuring your sit bones. So it's not a direct, your sit bones are this wide, this saddle's going to work for you. That adds to the picture. If we're then supporting our sit bones because we know the correct measurement and assuming the rest of the bike is set up correctly, mm-hmm. something that has very little padding, something like this, could be beneficial to someone. They could be very comfortable on something like this. If someone is running an excessive saddle height and they're potentially sitting off to one side or putting a lot of pressure through their soft tissue, one of the common things when that is too high is that someone wants to shift forwards to reduce that distance to the bottom bracket.
Yep.
They're going to be interacting with the front of the saddle. Now, a common shift is towards stubby nose or noseless saddles. Now, if there's mm-hmm. no nose to shift to, you're going to feel like you're shifting around. You're not going to find a comfortable position. So this is where traditional saddles, something like this without a cutout, a bit longer, maybe come stock on a bike. A lot of people will have a relative degree of comfort from something like this.
Yeah.
They may shift to a stubby nose saddle and hate it. Now, that may be due to the fact that other areas of the bike fit is not set up correctly.
Mm-hmm.
This is called your ischial tuberosity. This is what we want to be connected to the bike. Now, I normally explain this in the way that this is like your engine mounts in your car. You don't want this to be shifting around. So some people that shift around on the saddle a lot, you'd never want the engine mount in your car to be moving. You want it to be fixed and solid. So we want this structure here. We want to understand the width of this. And we want this to be planted on the saddle here. Obviously, our pelvis can be rotated forwards.
Yeah.
Depending on the position we're going to be running, but this sort of interaction, if let's say a saddle was too high, is what we could experience is sitting off to one side mm-hmm. like this. If we're sitting off to one side, this is where understanding left and right imbalances through using the camera. So mm-hmm. as I said at the start of the fit, I like to use my eyes and I like to communicate a lot first, but sometimes your eyes cannot pick up this. So understanding left and right imbalances and looking at the data, this is where this kind of informs our decisions. So if I can just get you, basically you want to get your sit bones on the blue line and just sit up straight naturally, how you would normally in a chair.
Okay.
Perfect, if you stand up. So it's measuring 119 millimeters. Now, I normally go about 12 to 20 millimeters above that when I'm looking at saddle width. So saddle widths commonly are sort of in the realms of 130, 140, 150. Mm-hmm. So I would say that like 120 millimeter reading is fairly generic. An important thing to remember, it's nothing to do with body size. So I've had some people that are 6'4" in here, really big guys, and they're measuring sort of 95 millimeters
mm-hmm.
as well. I've had some women, really small, sort of 4'8", and really wide measurements, sort of 140 millimeters.
Yeah.
Excessive saddle height where we're unstable through the bottom of the stroke can be really detrimental. So one thing we're looking at your knee extension, but also plantar flexion, so how much you're pointing your toes.
Mm-hmm.
See it really quite commonly. You'll naturally want to keep that knee extension that's kind of safe and normal. And you'll just find you point your toes a lot at the bottom of the stroke. And often people say to me, Yeah, but Matthew van der Poel does it. Yes, but Matthew van der Poel is also incredibly functional as an athlete. You sit at a desk all day. It's yeah. not the same
You're
thing.
You're not van der Poel. So yeah, I guess right now you could put it up slightly higher. But the problem with that is, you were saying a minute ago, if I'm then climbing up a hill, I might naturally drop my heel more, yeah. and then I'm outside of that zone.
100%. And this is where looking at not just the extension in your knee, but also sort of your plantar flexion as well is an important thing. We're now going to turn our attention to the front end.
Ooh.
So there's a few things I noticed initially. So yeah. I don't like to call them out straight away. I like to tick off sort of the foundation of your feet and that stability area, working on the engine room, let's say. And then I come to this. Two things I noticed initially was that when I asked you to come and grab hold of the bars, you're naturally wanting to hold sort of 10, 15 millimeters behind the lever.
Yeah.
Also, whenever there's any point when we're not in contact or I'm not speaking to you, you naturally sit up like this, which is a telltale sign of, I don't like the amount of pressure I've got on my hands. I want to come away from that. The initial thing I'm seeing from my eyes is that you're almost falling into the front of the bike.
Yeah.
Whether that's too long, too low, that's something we're going to trial. We're going to put the jig on, trial a few different things, and see how it feels to you. And now this is where science and data doesn't really come into it. This is where how it feels and how things look to me.
Yeah. So you're telling me that lower and longer isn't faster?
100%. So we know you've got some posterior chain tightness, a little bit of hamstring and lower back tightness.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be limited to that. The lower you go, you're not going to go beyond that. All that's going to happen is you're going to open up your frontal area. There's going to become a point where you can't go any lower, and all dropping the bars is going to do is open this gap. And this is where people see those pros on TV and they think, oh, they've all got their stems slammed, negative 20 degrees, and they're fast. I'm going to do that. That's not the case. Sometimes understanding your anatomy, your flexibility, your functionality, and then potentially bringing the bars closer to your head would be more beneficial. And this is a big trend we've seen in time trial bikes. So people are bringing those arms up, they're bringing their hands really close to the head. One of the most common changes I make at the front end is handlebar width. Now, handlebars come stock on bikes based on the frame size. Now, problem is upper body size changes dramatically based on height. You could have someone who's 6'2", who's a really slender build. You can have someone who's 6'2", who's a really broad build. The general consensus I'm seeing is that the bike industry tends to fit bars that are too wide for bikes.
I think certainly on performance bikes, then there's a lot to be gained from going narrower. Yeah.
So for you, you're quite broad. You're measuring sort of 42 centimeters wide, and we're on a 40 wide bar.
Yeah.
So for you, I wouldn't go any narrower.
No? Okay. No.
And for you as well, I would avoid turning the levers in, because all that's going to do is potentially, when you're getting into that aero position, which you're probably going to be sitting in for quite a lot of time when you're in a breakaway, you're going to put a lot of strain across your shoulders, potentially closing your ability to breathe, closing your chest area. So that's something we need to take into account. So I'm happy. I tend to match bar width with shoulder width within a degree of a couple centimeters. So I'm happy that 40 is a suitable width for you. One thing I do want to stress is that all of this is very functional related, and this is why I like to see people 6 to 8 weeks after a fit.
Yeah.
Is that I could give you a stretching routine now and you go away, do it a few times a week, and you come back in 8 weeks' time and the position you originally had may be fine for you.
Yeah.
That's something that if people are interested in a bike fit, always look at someone who's having multiple site visits, someone who's monitoring your progression and how you're adapting to it.
Yeah, it's not just a one-hit wonder.
It's not, no. It's a spectrum, and we kind of want to move along that spectrum.
So if I had a decent amount of time off the bike, then my fit, the perfect fit would change.
100%. Year on year, people get older, flexibility changes, injury, crashes, so many things change, and how you interact with the bike is going to change as well. So we kind of wanted to monitor that and importantly, see your initial acute adaptation to that.
Well, that's my position all sorted. And even though I thought I'd been pretty meticulous in how I'd set up my cleats and saddle, there were some things that needed changing. And well, hopefully I'll be a lot more comfortable now. There's some things that you just can't do at home. Like, I don't have the lasers, I don't have Luke's insight into positions or the ability to look at my position from across a room. So there's definitely some things that you just can't get from doing a bike fit at home. It might seem expensive. So a bike fit like this that took around 3 hours today would normally cost £220, which I do get, it seems like a lot. But as far as upgrades go for your bike, that is an insane upgrade, like compared to a new stem or a fancy oversized pulley wheel system. You could increase your performance no end and be more comfortable on your bike, enjoy your riding more. And to me, that's well worth it. So I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, then please give us a like, subscribe to the channel, and we'll see you next time.